Thank you very much for the kind invitation, and congratulations to Esteve for again organize this very interesting meeting that I think has been, it will be very, very fruitful. Well, I've been asked to talk about electronic cigarettes in the European Union Tobacco Products Directive. And, well, I'll speak a little bit about the Tobacco Products Directive, but of course I would like to say something about the different regulations in the different countries, and we are in Spain, and I will be very happy talking about what is happening in Spain in parallel to the directive. And, well, as it's late and as we are in Spain, and I've been allowed by Esteve, I'll propose you the exercise of hearing me in Spanish and in English, first when I speak about Spain in Spanish, and after in English. So I think we can keep the interest and the in this time that is really the last conference, but it's an interesting exercise. So I'll start speaking about which aspects are regulated by the directive and which not. And I think this is the first that we should enter to consider, because not everything is regulated by the directive, of course. The directive regulates those aspects the European Parliament and the Council are competent to regulate, that's clear, but it does not regulate those aspects the Member States are competent for. And now, I'll change to Spain, so please, to Spanish. Because now I'll speak what's happening and how, in Europe, the directives, why it starts? Well, I can go a little bit more in English while you are changing there. Why a directive? Well, because the directive, it comes from 2001, and it was necessary to have a change in this directive, to update the directive. The directive from those years, many things has changed in the field of tobacco control, in the field of tobacco addiction, and it was necessary to update. For instance, all the countries of Europe and the European Union itself has signed the FCTC agreement with the World Health Organization, the framework, the tobacco control, the frame convention for tobacco control. And also, talking about electronic cigarettes, in 2001, they didn't exist. So it was interesting to regulate some aspects of electronic cigarettes. And now I'll change to Spanish. Los Estados miembros, ¿me oís? Bien. Los Estados miembros tienen que transponer la directiva, obligatoriamente. Tienen que desarrollar una legislación en cada país que que implemente todas estas medidas en lo que se refiere a los aspectos europeos. Y es una oportunidad la transposición para además incluir otras cosas. En cualquier caso, os decía antes que los estados legislan y algunos han empezado a legislar ya en relación con el cigarrillo electrónico. Y en los distintos estados hay diferentes niveles legislativos. Entonces, quería hablar un poquito del estado español y de las diferentes regiones de España. Los estados miembros no pueden legislar en contra de la directiva. Y esto, por ejemplo, va a ser una oportunidad para España. Y me voy a explicar. Me voy a explicar a continuación. En muchos aspectos, sí se puede, como decía Martina esta mañana, regular más allá de la directiva, por ejemplo. En cuestiones de empaquetado, Irlanda, sabéis todos que pasar a un empaquetado genérico, un empaquetado plano, que a los que trabajamos en control del tabaquismo nos parece una muy buena medida. Esto puede ser una oportunidad para todos los países. Pero voy a empezar a hablar un poquito de por qué puede ser una oportunidad para España el que haya que transponer la directiva. Bien. El proceso de la directiva es largo. Empieza con una propuesta de la Comisión que se traslada a los otros dos órganos de Europa. Europa tiene la Comisión, la Unión Europea, y tiene el Parlamento y tiene el Consejo. El Parlamento son los eurodiputados, los miembros del Parlamento, elegidos por los ciudadanos. Y el Consejo son los gobiernos de los países. Cuando la Comisión propone una directiva, la envía a los dos órganos, al Parlamento y al Consejo. se debate, se discute, se llega a acuerdos en los dos sitios, después se ponen de acuerdo, se vota en el Parlamento y se aprueba. Eso es lo que ha ocurrido con la directiva, con una serie de problemas por en medio que la han ido retrasando, que nos han hecho pensar que al final no iba a salir en tiempo, que iba a haber elecciones en Europa y que nos íbamos a quedar sin directiva hasta dentro de unos años, con una gran preocupación de que esto fuese así, porque indiscutiblemente la directiva del 2001 estaba desfasada en muchos aspectos. Bueno, pues en los países, ¿qué ha ocurrido? Que entre tanto se veía necesaria y urgente algún tipo de regulación, porque el fenómeno del cigarrillo electrónico empezaba a crecer tremendamente sin ningún tipo de regulación y todo el mundo estaba de acuerdo en que había que hacer algo para regularlos. Concretamente en España, el primer sitio donde empezó a verse esta necesidad fue Cataluña. En Cataluña se propuso hacer algún tipo de modificación. Alguna otra comunidad hizo lo mismo y en España tenemos un sistema nacional de salud que tiene un órgano que se llama el Consejo Interterritorial, que en el que las autoridades sanitarias de cada región española se ponen de acuerdo para que los españoles no tengan diferencias en cuanto a su derecho a la salud si viven en una región o en otra. Bueno, pues en el Consejo Interterritorial se discutió sobre los problemas del cigarrillo electrónico y cómo abordar, bueno, pues algún tipo de restricciones, por ejemplo, en venta a menores, en muchas cosas. Y también se empezó a hablar de lo que no era competencia de la Unión Europea. La Unión Europea regula, y más hubo muchas confusiones. Hubo un ejemplo, no ya en el cigarrillo electrónico, pero curioso, ¿no? En la comunidad de Navarra, por ejemplo, hubo una preocupación terrible porque se empezó a decir que la directiva iba a prohibir la venta en máquinas de tabaco. Es cierto que en un primer borrador, muy primero, algo se decía de esto, pero en cuanto pasó por el filtro jurídico de la Comisión Europea, esto se retiró porque la venta en máquinas es competencia nacional. Sin embargo, asistimos estupefactos los ciudadanos de este país a declaraciones de altos cargos de la Comunidad de Navarra, incluso a manifestaciones fuera de sentido. ¿Y pues por qué? Porque resulta que en Navarra hay una fábrica que se llama Azcoyen que distribuye todas las máquinas de tabaco para toda Europa. Entonces, en Navarra estaban muy preocupados por una desinformación terrible, probablemente interesada. Bien. Después de todo esto, el Consejo Interterritorial llegó a una serie de acuerdos en cuanto a cómo controlar los cigarrillos electrónicos. Y tuvimos algunas declaraciones que los que trabajamos, insisto, en control del tabaquismo, vimos positivas. Nuestra ministra de Sanidad llegó a decir que iba a haber una regulación similar a la del tabaco, lo cual veíamos bien, por una medida de prudencia elemental. Y tenemos un sistema de dos cámaras en España, un Congreso de los Diputados y un Senado. El Consejo Interterritorial, que llegó a algunos acuerdos, se dio cuenta de que realmente la forma de hacer una ley en España era modificar la ley que había para darle validez. Y el Congreso de los Diputados tenía que hacer una modificación de la ley 2005, la ley del tabaco primera que teníamos en nuestro país, para incluir el cigarrillo electrónico y poder regularlo. Esto se hizo así y nosotros, los sanitarios, y insisto, la gente de este mundo del control del tabaco, pensamos que lo que se había dicho iba a ocurrir, es decir, que se iba a hacer una regulación muy similar a la de a la que existía para el resto de productos del tabaco. Y para nuestra sorpresa, en el Congreso se hizo una regulación muy distinta, donde efectivamente hay unos aspectos que, yo diría tres niveles. Uno es el de los espacios de consumo, otro nivel era el de los impuestos que afectan a los cigarrillos electrónicos y al tabaco, y otro nivel podría ser, bueno, fundamentalmente en estos dos niveles habría competencia nacional. Y un nivel en el que no habría competencia nacional, que sería el nivel en el que tiene la competencia Europa, pero que se reguló también para poder tener algo hasta que llegase la transposición de la directiva, que es el de la publicidad. ¿Vale? Bien, para sorpresa nuestra, en el Congreso de los Diputados se hizo una regulación que quedaba muy corta, en nuestra opinión, en cuanto a espacios de consumo, porque se limitaba, como bien se había dicho antes, a la administración, a los hospitales, a una serie de sitios, con lo cual parece que, hombre, vamos a ver, o el cigarrillo electrónico es preocupante y es peligroso o no lo es. Yo creo que igual de peligroso ha de ser en un hospital o en un jardín de infancia, en un transporte público, que en un bar. y volvemos a repetir un poco lo que ocurrió con la ley 2005. O sea, al final, los profesionales de la hostelería o los señores que trabajan en todos los bares tienen que estar sometidos a algo que a lo mejor es tóxico. Probablemente no lo sea y no sea tanto, o no lo sea, vamos a ver, no será inocuo, pero no será tan tóxico como el tabaco. Pero, bueno, una medida de prudencia que se aplica a unos sectores habría que aplicar a todos. Esa era la posición de los sanitarios. En cuanto a los impuestos, hombre, nosotros pensamos que la razón de que el tabaco esté gravado con un impuesto muy alto, mucho más que el IVA, es porque el tabaco es adictivo, es muy adictivo y es muy tóxico. Entendemos que el cigarro electrónico es adictivo y es tóxico, ¿vale? Entonces, entendíamos que esto se iba a regular así, como había dicho la ministra. Y luego, en cuanto a la publicidad, todos pensamos que ya que hay que transponer una directiva dentro de un año, donde se prohíbe, como veremos después, cuando repasemos la directiva, la publicidad exactamente igual que la del tabaco en toda Europa, y se va a prohibir así cuando se transponga la directiva, pues era una oportunidad de oro para regularlo de esa manera. Para nuestra sorpresa no fue así. En el Congreso hubo una regulación, ya digo, en la que la publicidad tenía unas restricciones. Por ejemplo, en televisión solamente se prohibía hacer propaganda en lo que denominaban horario infantil, que es de 4 a 8. Y en los cines, solamente en aquellas películas que estuvieran especialmente destinadas a los niños o jóvenes. Bueno, a nosotros no nos pareció bien. Y entonces el CNPT, que yo presido, que es una sociedad de 30 y... Bueno, aquí pone, son unas 30 sociedades científicas y asociaciones sanitarias y, bueno, profesionales sanitarios, nos preocupó. Y con la OMC, con la Organización Médica Colegial, hicimos una rueda de prensa donde expresamos a la opinión pública nuestra preocupación por lo que había ocurrido en el Congreso de los Diputados. Hicimos un documento, que está en nuestra web, lo pueden ustedes ver, donde pone ahí 37, al final fueron 42, porque se sumaron algunas más, pero todos los sanitarios de este país y casi todas las sociedades científicas, las más importantes, compartieron y compartimos este posicionamiento en estas tres líneas que les acabo de explicar. Es decir, refiriéndonos a los impuestos, a los espacios de consumo y a la publicidad. Y hacíamos especial hincapié en la preocupación que teníamos de que nuestros políticos hubiesen legislado algo en contra de lo que nuestros mismos políticos habían legislado en Bruselas y nuestro gobierno había aprobado en Bruselas. Nuestro gobierno, el gobierno de España, participó muy activamente en los debates de la directiva. Y la posición fue muy clara, a favor de lo que luego dijo la directiva, que es una prohibición clara de la publicidad, en los cigarrillos electrónicos, ahora me estoy refiriendo. Sin embargo, para nuestra sorpresa, el no fue así. Bueno, esto lo hicimos justo después de la aprobación en el Congreso de la modificación de ley que se hizo. Y nos dirigimos a todos los senadores de la Comisión de Sanidad, donde se discutió. Como además nos pilló de sorpresa, no sé cómo traducirán esto, como nos cogió de sorpresa la posición de los partidos políticos, que era distinta a la del Gobierno, y el apoyo que hubo de todos en el Congreso de los Diputados a esta modificación, nos sorprendió mucho. Hablamos con todos, o con casi todos, con los que quisieron hablar con nosotros, y les trasladamos esta preocupación, además explicando... Perdón. ...que venía desde los sanitarios de este país. Esta es la lista de sociedades que habíamos firmado este manifiesto. Y bueno, pues el resultado fue el que fue. That means, quiere decir, que todos los partidos políticos cambiaron de posición, excepto uno, que fue el Partido Popular. Entonces, en el Senado, ¿qué ocurrió? Que todos los partidos políticos votaron en contra de esta posición, menos el Partido Popular, que tenía mayoría absoluta. Y nos quedamos con la ley, como les he explicado, con una ley que, en cuanto a los espacios, recuerda a la del 2005, que hubo que cambiar después, porque por una serie de razones que les he comentado, que en cuanto a impuestos, bueno, pues trata excesivamente bien a un producto que, en cuanto lleva nicotina, es adictivo y que, bueno, pues debería ser considerado fiscalmente, entendemos, de otra manera. Y en cuanto a la publicidad, inexplicablemente, no concordaba con lo que yo espero que en un corto plazo de tiempo, y como máximo no llegará a 2 años, será traspuesto a la legislación nacional, que es la legislación europea, que, insisto, nuestro Gobierno y el mismo partido político había apoyado tanto en el Parlamento de Bruselas como en el Consejo Europeo. Una pequeña cosa que no acabamos de entender. Bueno, y así estábamos. Es curioso que el único partido político fíjense en la fecha, tenía yo por aquí el día 30 de mayo... Y no fue el 31 de mayo, que a ustedes les suena como Día Mundial sin Tabaco. El 31 de mayo este año fue sábado. Los políticos los sábados no trabajan. No los políticos, sino el Congreso no registra documentos. Pero el PSOE presentó el día 30 de mayo, coincidiendo con el Día Mundial sin Tabaco, una proposición no de ley al Congreso de los Diputados que recogía, además lo decía al principio, las propuestas de los sanitarios de este país. Recogía los tres aspectos que yo a ustedes les estoy contando. Bueno, evidentemente no prosperó porque no tiene mayoría este partido político y ahí se quedó. Bueno, vamos a volver a pasar un poquito a la directiva en sí y voy a ser un poco polémico porque, bueno, ¿por qué cigarrillos electrónicos en la directiva? Algunos colegas míos han defendido que no es el lugar para los cigarrillos electrónicos, en una directiva de productos del tabaco. Bien, la directiva no se llama directiva de productos del tabaco, se llama directiva de tabaco y productos relacionados con el tabaco. Ahí está el encaje de la directiva, de los cigarrillos electrónicos en esta directiva. Evidentemente son unos productos relacionados con el tabaco, no son tabaco. Pero, bien, debe de encajar ahí. Y, de hecho, hay un título 3 en la directiva que se llama específicamente cigarrillos electrónicos y productos herbales o hierbas. Y hay un capítulo 20, muy amplio, del que vamos a hablar ahora un poquito más en profundidad, que se refiere específicamente a los cigarrillos electrónicos. Este es el encaje del cigarrillo electrónico en la directiva europea. Bueno, hemos comentado antes cómo nos pilló de sorpresa a muchos el tremendo debate que hubo al final en relación con el cigarrillo electrónico. La directiva estaba hecha, fundamentalmente, para tratar dos temas, que eran los aditivos y las advertencias gráficas. Porque el interés de la directiva, fundamentalmente, era el que menos jóvenes se incorporasen al consumo de tabaco y que nuestros jóvenes en Europa fumasen menos. Esa era la intención de la directiva. Y por eso hubo grandes, grandes debates y nosotros hicimos nuestro pequeño tarea de lobby, los sanitarios españoles, con nuestros diputados, que fueron bastante receptivos. Bueno, de todo hubo, pero creo que fue interesante el aspecto. Por lo menos conocieron de primera mano lo que pensábamos los sanitarios de este país en relación con los aditivos, y digo principalmente el mentol, porque el mentol supuso una gran discusión con unos tremendos intereses y es una de las cosas que para mí peor quedaron en la directiva. O sea, lo que se ha hecho con el mentol, para que no es el momento ahora, estamos hablando de cigarrillos electrónicos, pero para mí fue uno de los grandes fallos de la directiva, cómo se dejó el mentol. Fue una solución de compromiso para salir adelante, pero desde luego, hombre, ya del azúcar ni se habló. O sea, el azúcar desde el principio se dejó aparte. El azúcar en su combustión es cancerígeno, evidentemente. Lo que pasa es que si se prohibía el azúcar, pues habría problemas de competencia entre el tabaco europeo y el tabaco de otros sitios, y eso desde el principio se dejó aparte. O sea que realmente hay muchas cosas que decir de la directiva, pero vamos a ir a los cigarrillos electrónicos. Insisto, empezaron los debates con las advertencias gráficas, que si más grandes, que si más bajas, que si tal, que si cual, con los aditivos, y de repente entró en escena el cigarrillo electrónico. Ya cuando estaba casi acabándose el tema, faltaba poco tiempo para acabar la legislatura, la directiva había dimitido un comisario de salud, parecía que no iba a dar tiempo, yo creo que la industria del tabaco se frotaba las manos porque la directiva se retrasaría unos años, parecía que ya se había resuelto lo de los aditivos y de repente aparecen los cigarrillos electrónicos y nuestros colegas, algunos decían, no, esto tiene que estar en la directiva de medicamentos, otros decían, no, tiene que estar en la directiva de tabaco. Bueno, pues empezó el debate, casi se pelean, a punto estuvo de fracasar la directiva, el hacerla en tiempo por culpa de los cigarrillos electrónicos. Bueno, esto es lo que digo que puede ser conflictivo y acepto todo tipo de opiniones. Mi impresión personal es que la regulación que tiene la directiva de cigarrillos electrónicos es muy buena. No se consideran medicamentos, solamente cuando tengan más de 20 miligramos por mililitro de nicotina y cuando digan que sirven para dejar de fumar. O sea, si alguien intenta colocar un producto en el mercado que dice que sirve para dejar de fumar, eso es un medicamento, eso es lo que dice la directiva, y así están considerados, y yo entiendo que debe ser así. ¿Pero qué tiene de bueno esto? Vamos a ver, si dicen que sirven para dejar de fumar, habrá que demostrar muchas cosas, habrá que hacer muchos más controles, será un producto con una serie de indicaciones, y entra una regulación, una directiva distinta, mucho más estricta. Pero, entre tanto, los cigarrillos electrónicos, que no tenían regulación, que proliferaban sin ningún tipo de control, y con peligros y con muchos riesgos, van a pasar a estar con una regulación más estricta y con todas las restricciones que se le aplican al tabaco, los productos del tabaco. dentro de lo que es competencia europea. Si esto luego hay competencias nacionales, pero la filosofía de la directiva es que tengan las mismas restricciones que el tabaco, como bien dijo nuestra ministra de Sanidad que se iba a hacer en España y que luego no fue posible. Bien. Bueno, y esto es la directiva en sí. La directiva 2014/40 dice que es sobre la aproximación del... Voy a pasar a hablar en inglés ahora en la directiva en sí. On the approximation of the laws, regulation and administrative provisions of the member states concerning the manufacture, presentation and sale of tobacco and related products and repealing the last directive, the other directive. Okay? Well, in the beginning of the directive, I'll go a little bit. Yo creo que voy un poco justo ya. Bye. 5 minutes. Well, I'll try to go fast. Well, in the beginning we have 60 discoursing articles in the preamble. Very, very interesting. Very interesting. From the 36 to 48, they are speaking about electronic cigarettes. Just about electronic cigarettes, and that's very interesting. That's important. They came in the beginning of the directive, and they are not dispositive articles, but they shed light on the intentions of the legislators. That's very, very interesting. I only will remark here two of these discoursing articles in the preamble. The 43 that says that electronic cigarettes can develop into a gateway to nicotine addiction and ultimately traditional tobacco consumption as they mimic and normalize the action of smoking. For this reason, it is appropriate to adopt a restrictive approach to advertising electronic cigarettes and refill containers. This is the aim of the directive. Oh, it's in the preamble, but I think we must have this in mind, okay? And the 46, talks about some reports and says that the Commission should report on the potential risk associated with refillable electronic cigarettes by 20th May of 2016, but let's see, sorry. Well, then after this preamble, this first part, comes the legislative aspects, and this the first title is common provisions. The title two is tobacco products. We'll not say anything because tobacco products is not the aim of this conference. And the title C is electronic cigarettes and herbal products for smoking. Okay, well, in the title one, in the subject matter, we can read that the objective of the directive is to approximate the law, regulation, and administrative provisions of the member states concerning the ingredients and emissions of tobacco products. But, well, I'll go faster. The point F is the placing on the market and the labeling of certain products which are related to tobacco products, namely electronic cigarettes and refill containers and herbal products for smoking. In order to facilitate the smooth functioning of the internal market for tobacco and related products, taking as a base a high level of protection of human health, especially for young people, and to meet the obligations of the Union under the World Health Organization Framework Convention for Tobacco Control. That's important. Well, the Article 2, it has many, many definitions, but for us it's interesting what says that is electronic cigarette, the directive. That is saying that electronic cigarette means a product that can be used for consumption of nicotine-containing vapor via a mouthpiece or any component of that product, including a cartridge, a tank, and the device without cartridge or tank. Electronic cigarettes can be disposable or refillable by means of a refill container and a tank, or rechargeable with single-use cartridges. Well, and refill container means a receptacle that contains a nicotine-containing liquid which can be used to refill an electronic cigarette. Those are the definitions of what we are talking about for a couple of minutes, sorry. And the Title III is the one that talks and speaks and regulates electronic cigarettes and herbal products for the market. And the Article 20 in this Title III is devoted to electronic cigarettes. Well, now I'll go faster. I'll explain what, for me, is the most interesting that we can find in this Article 20, the previous notification. Well, manufacturers and importers shall submit a notification to the competent authorities of the member states 6 months before placing them in the market. That's important. That's very important. And what about what we have? cual, if already placed on the market on 20 of May is the limit of the transposition of 2016, the notification shall be submitted within 6 months. So that affects to all electronic cigarettes that are in the European Union. And a new notification, of course, shall be submitted for each substantial modification of the product. That's important. That's a thing that we must consider, and it's a first regulation of what we had, that it was absolutely deregulated. Regarding the liquid, and I go very fast, because we can read this in the, I didn't want to talk, to read the directive. You can do it, you can find it in the web of the European Parliament. The liquid is important to say that disposables, electronic cigarettes and single-use cartridges, they must have a maximum of 10 milliliters, this is what is regulated, and the cartridges or tanks, the maximum is 2 milliliters, okay? And the most important, the nicotine concentration, the maximum is 20 milligrams per milliliter. In other cases, they are considered as medicaments. That's very important. What the European Parliament, the European Commission, the European Union regulates is the level, the electronic cigarette with maximum 20 milligrams per milliliter. Well, and there's a lot of things that they cannot have. Member States shall prohibit the placing on the market of tobacco products containing the following additives: vitamins or other additives that create the impression that the tobacco product has a health benefit or presents reduced health risks. That's very important. Caffeine or taurine or other additives and stimulant compounds that are associated with energy and vitality, exactly the same than tobacco. Additives having coloring properties for emissions. For tobacco products for smoking, additives that facilitates inhalation or nicotine uptake, very important, and additives that have CMR. CMR is carcinogenic, mutagenic, or reproductive aspects in unburned form, before being, because this is toll for tobacco, but is applied also in this, not in other additives, but in this, at least, for electronic cigarettes. And see what says here. Except for nicotine, only ingredients are used in the nicotine-containing liquid that do not pose a risk to human health, except nicotine, says, huh? Right? A risk to human health in heated or unheated form. Electronic cigarettes deliver the nicotine dust at consistent levels under normal conditions of use. And this is important. I think it's very good that people that use electronic cigarettes will have these properties and this regulation. Also introduces some regulation on safety, and says that electronic cigarette and refill containers are child and tamper-proof, are protected against breakage and leakage, and have a mechanism that ensures refilling without leakage. That was important, and now it's regulated. Leaflets. Well, now we need information. Consumers need information, and it should be necessary to have information, warnings. Every unit package of electronic cigarettes and refill containers include a leaflet with information on instruction for use and storage, contraindications, warning for specific risk groups, possible adverse effects, addictiveness and toxicity, and contact details of the manufacturer or importer. That sounds very logical. And every unit packet and any outside packaging of electronic cigarettes and refill containers shall include a list of ingredients contained in the product, in the standing order of the weight, and an indication of the nicotine content of the product, and the delivery per dose, the batch number, and recommendations to keep the product out of reach of children. We have heard that sometimes there's nicotine and they say no, well, this it will be regulated with the directive, and I think it's good. Without prejudice to point one of this point, we do not include elements or features referred to it in Article 13 concerning information on the nicotine content and flowering, and carry on one of the following warnings. This product contains nicotine, which is a highly addictive substance. It is not recommendable for use by non-smokers, or without the last sentence. This product contains nicotine, which is a highly addictive substance, and that depends on every member state to choose one or the other one. And health warnings will comply with the requirements of another article. Well, And what is for me very important, the advertising provision, and I'm finishing, I'm just finishing. Well, the commercial communications in information society services in the press and other printed publications with the aim or direct or indirect effect of promoting electronic cigarettes and refill containers are prohibited, except for publications that are intended exclusively for professionals in the trade of electronic cigarettes or refill containers, and for publications which are printed and published in third countries whose those publications are not principally intended for the union. It's forbidden to make publicity of electronic cigarettes in the press. Of course, on the radio, exactly the same. Of course, well, any form of public on radio programs, okay, more or less the same. And any form of public or private contribution to any event, activity, or individual person with the aim or direct or indirect effect of promoting electronic cigarettes and refill containers and involving or taking place in several members having cross-border effects should be prohibited. And audiovisual commercial communications to which directive the European Parliament applies are prohibited for electronic cigarettes and refill containers. Also, on TV and cinema is prohibited to make publicity of electronic cigarettes. Very, very clear. Very, very clear. So our country will have to put this in the next law, of course, when we'll transpose. I don't know why they didn't do before and they have not to work twice, but anyway, that's not our government, because it was the government, I think, it has very clear that. The problem is with our politicians, the parliamentarians, and so on. Information to member states. This, I think, is the last one. A system for collecting information about all the suspected adverse effects on human health of this product. That was absolutely logic. This feedback between the different countries of Europe is absolutely essential. Different member states must inform one to other of everything that we will discover regarding the safety of these products. We must defend the health of our citizens, and that's the most important. And just let me read five conclusions. Very fast, sorry. Well, the directive provides a stricter regulation of electronic cigarettes, that's clear. They are considered medicinal products if their nicotine content is higher than 20 milligrams per milliliter or if therapeutic properties are claimed, that's very important. It limits additives, not all, but it limits additives, of course. It requires security measures for minors, that's very important, that's what we are trying to work for. It requires more information on components and effects to be provided to users. It's important. Recognize their risks and limits its promotion and advertising and their availability by minors. It obliges to member states to inform about the adverse effects detected. And that's all. Well, sorry because I've been 5 minutes more, but I started to talk about my country and at the end, but I'm sorry. Thank you very, very much.
It was so important that you finished. Please take place now. And we have 20 minutes now for discussion. Please, who is interested to? Yes, please. Do we have, please, a microphone for the questions or comments? It would be. Oh, here. Oh, it's here. Okay. Barbro from Sweden.
Could you possibly put on the conclusions once more? It was too quickly.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, no. It's here? One. Yeah, I have it.
I didn't have time to read them.
So let's start with our last presentation, because it's now very fresh and very exciting to know what will be done in the next 2 years. In Spain and in the rest of Europe. Do you have any questions or comments to this? Please. Elif Dagli.
Yes, from Turkey. did I see it correctly or not? There was an article which said that nothing dangerous to human health except for nicotine can be put. I'm a lung physician, I'm a pediatric pulmonologist. Nothing except for air should go into the lungs. So you cannot assume that the rest is not harmful. How will it work? I cannot understand it.
Francesco, do you have an answer, a solution?
Well, it's not easy, the answer, of course. I think that what they are trying to explain, that if we do discover that some of the ingredients it have some effect, not what you say, I agree with you, but probably they want to go a little bit far away. And what they say is that some product that it will be claimed as with some type of effect, not only, you say that only air, but anything, I think it, I can't answer you really, because I understand what you are telling, but at least what says, for me, the most important is that says that nicotine is toxic there. Mm. They are recognizing the toxicity of nicotine. And after that, well, I don't know if you can. Martina is an expert in probably in this, than me in the directive. She has been in Brussels.
I think this is a very sophisticated question, and I have no answer so far, because I think the main content is propylene glycol, and you as pneumologist, you know exactly that it's not it harms the health of people to inhaling, especially so much and so often as with these products. So this is an open question indeed. Yeah. The other thing is I think the additives like flavors which makes which increases allergies maybe, or which are contact allergens, they should not be allowed, such as menthol also. Menthol and vanillin or others. So, but it must be tested and this is now a huge task, I think, for science, for medical science and for researchers, to give good advice to regulators and to their governments. Which substances should be out and banned from the beginning?
Maybe that opens the door to what you are telling. Maybe if the health community can demonstrate very clear the problems with some of the additives, maybe this gives an opportunity to change that and leaves an open door to that. So it's a starting point.
My question is, are the member states, are they obliged to regulate it as a medical product if the nicotine content is higher than 20? Are they obliged
yes.
to do that?
Yes, mm-hmm. yes, because there was that, yes.
Yeah. Other question to the regulation and to the presentation by Francisco?
Sorry for being so naive.
No,
what determines the threshold of 20 milligrams? Is it an arbitrary figure? Or is it the amount found in normal cigarettes, classical cigarettes? Is that why you have the threshold? Does it mean that less than 20 milligrams is okay for human health? That is that sort of perception that people will have.
I think 20 milligrams is the equivalent to one pack of. I can answer to a cigarette.
Hmm. So they calculated an equivalent to cigarettes. But you know, if you inhale deeply, you have a higher nicotine content. So it's quite critical to have thresholds like this. It's true, but this was a big debate in the parliament.
My name is Dilek, and I'm from Turkey, Ankara. There are some challenging and there are conflicts about regulatory documents, as far as I have seen. What's your practical solution or recommendation to the civil societies located in different parts of the world? Because I think it needs a lot of change in this regulation, practical way. Thank you.
I think it was necessary a regulation. I think it was very good to have electronic cigarettes inside this directive. conflicts. Well, I think this is a starting point. This is, of course, not a closed directive. We have the opportunity of reporting all what we will discover, we will demonstrate, and I think in the future we will have to go far away. But I want to say that in this line, the member states have many things to do, because we have in Europe many independence to certain aspects, and this is only a framework where we will go in one or another direction. But at least we have some things that are very clear, and that's why we think that it has been a successful directive. First of all, because we have directive. We could not have directive. Huh? And the second is that this is a starting point where it is, there are some things now, there are regulation of a product that is not absolutely safe. That's clear. So this needs some regulation. That here it will, for us in Spain, it will open a door, because until now we could have all type of publicity of this product. Now not. We'll fight because in the future this will change. I explained the position of my country regarding places, regarding all taxes, for instance. We'll support that. The theme of this day, of the World No Tobacco Day, was very clear regarding taxes, regarding the price of the tobacco products and so on. I think this is a starting point. I think it was absolutely necessary to have a regulation, and we personally think that this has been positive. Now we have much to do, much work to do, and this is a starting point. What to recommend to other countries? I think it has another thing very important is the influence of Europe in the rest of the world, not only in including the States, in other parts of the world. I think it's very important. I think next step will be here the document of World Health Organization with the conclusions. I think we are waiting or seeing what's being regulated in the United States from the CDC. I think we are preparing a framework that it will be more sensate and more clear. But of course, having in mind the precaution as principal point of view from our from the health professions and from the health authorities, I hope so.
Next comment or question, please.
Yes, my question is for Marisa.
Okay.
First of all, I would congratulate you for your explanation. It has been very interesting. And you have explained the relation, the links within the tobacco industry and the electronic industry, electronic cigarette industry. But what about the hidden strategy within the tobacco industry, the electronic cigarette industry, and the cannabis industry? Because the device is able to vaporize too the cannabis. Have you explored any hidden strategy about this?
So you're talking about cannabis in vaporizers, yeah? Using the e-cigarette as a device, as a mechanism? Is that what you mean, cannabis, yeah? So the one quote that we had is from a company that is positioning itself in America. You all know the regulation even within the United States is very divided, and the FDA is working overtime at the moment. But one company has positioned itself as what it likes to call a leader in this, and so it's using the same mechanism for legalized marijuana, and that is its marketing tool. And it's really fascinating. I was watching a little news video thing. It was on one of the big news channels in America, where the CEO, the founder of this company, was on promoting it, you know, and talking about it very openly, and how because marijuana, cannabis is legal in certain parts. I know Martina also mentioned in her talk, you know, the cannabis
from Netherlands.
From the Netherlands, because obviously they're also more liberal there. So in countries where we have more liberalized sort of towards that, it's already happening. Mm-hmm. And it was really interesting, that same company that's using, my understanding, that's using legalized marijuana as its tool, is at the same time got another product on the market. And this is the whole business strategy. It's diversification. You know, you spread out and you try different things. Mm-hmm. And its other product is a nicotine-free flavor device, which uses vitamins. you know, in it. And so those are the two that it's got. And it's positioning itself on the market as an exceptional leader. And I think, my guess is that as, you know, this is just a technology and it's just at the beginning. We've got big tobacco companies now investing in heat and burn technologies. E-cigarettes are just the beginning. You know, there are many more products that are in the pipeline. I think we're going to see more and more and more of these products emerging. This is just the start. It's my prediction.
But I think somebody even mentioned alcohol. Was it you, Martina?
Yeah.
Alcohol? Is that a taste or do they really have alcohol in the blood?
They use a drink, the extracts from drinks. Mm. To put it the flavor. However, however, regarding alcohol, in the blogger scene of the e-cigarette consumers, they are advising how to mix it up, how to mix the liquids up with alcohol, for example, with brandy or with whiskey or whatever. Please, Marisa.
And if I'm not just triggered off, if I'm not mistaken, there was something called the Vapertini that came out very recently, which was the first, my understanding, it was one of the first alcohol vaporizing. So this is actual alcohol. Yeah. So I think now we're...
A liquid with alcohol in it.
I'm not entirely, but I think they were moving towards using the technology for alcohol, yeah. And I know Jared Hastings, who's not here, but he believes, and he says this a lot, that, you know, this is just the start of a new form of consumption.
Yeah.
You know, because we're heading towards the future. You know, do you remember Back to the Future, the films, where we all speculated about hoverboards? You know, this we're moving. I mean, I'm not saying maybe. But, you know, this is not, we're not taking big leaps anymore. You know, this is a new way of consumption. And, you know, he does believe that even food consumption and things, you know, in the future might be used in these different mechanisms. So, I don't know. You know, who would have thought that we would have been listening to music and calling while having a vape at the same time 2 years ago?
Yes, please. Over there.
In the case of the products that contain more than 20 milligrams of nicotine, that they are considered medicinal products, does this mean that they have to be sold by medical prescription and therefore to be sold in pharmacies rather than in e-cigarette shops? Or can it be sold as an over-the-counter medicine? And under which grounds there can be claiming therapeutic properties if there are not effectiveness studies being done or very few so far? And what will be the position of doctors in lack of evidence about it?
Well, in that case, they enter in other directive, not in the tobacco products directive, in the medicines directive. I don't know exactly if they are have to be sold or they are sold over the country. Over the counter, I don't know exactly that.
It depends of the country. For example, in UK, you have a different legislation regarding over the counter. So they are selling, for example, also aspirin and other the OTC products in supermarkets and in drogeries and not in the protected area of pharmacies. Like however, in most of the other European countries, and also Spain, I think.
In Spain, you have
in the pharmacy.
Sold, not as in the United Kingdom, in the pharmacy, yes.
In the pharmacy,
But it depends, but also what I tried to explain before, is that it's very different directive. It's much more strict and it's absolutely different. And not only when they are over 20 milligrams, but also when the manufacturer or the who is selling says that it's useful to quit smoking. In that case, it's considered a medicament, so it's used for that, and then it must be considered not a tobacco product, but a medicament. It's different function. Mm-hmm. It sounds logic. And then it needs to, and we have seen, for instance, in Spain, I don't know in other countries, that from this moment when everyone realized that this was in this way, this is in this way, and this it should not be changed. It can't be changed. The people that is selling electronic cigarette is not telling more, at least here, that these products are useful to quit smoking. They will have a very long process. They will have to demonstrate many things, much more things than now. And I think that's interesting. I think that's in the sake of the consumers. I think our citizens need to be protected and need to when they try to buy a medicament, they need other warranties than buying tobacco products. And I think that's what I try to explain. Depends in every country. Depends in regulation. Depends on many mm-hmm. things. But at mm-hmm. least this is a different level of regulation, and that's mm-hmm. what I try to explain.
Marisa, please.
Certainly in the UK, just to add to that, you might find interesting, we've gone a slightly different route. Mm-hmm. They've gone down the route of pharmaceutical regulation. So they want e-cigarettes to be licensed as medicinal products. But the regulation says that it won't come in until 2016. Now that's the same as the TPD, am I right? Yeah? So we have this 2-year gap. And what's happening at the moment is our products, or some of the big companies, tobacco companies included, are now getting their products licensed as medicines in the UK as we speak. But interestingly enough, two e-cigarettes that are owned by tobacco companies in the UK are being sold in pharmacies, okay? And they're available at point of sale with two leading pharmacies, even though they have not been licensed as medicines yet. So we were already starting to see, because there is this gap in legislation and policy, we're starting to see some really, really interesting marketing strategies already emerging in that sense. So.
A ver, quería hacer una pregunta. Por un lado se está hablando de que de alguna manera en Inglaterra se está vendiendo en farmacias. Marisa, quizás para ti. ¿Por qué? Porque se está vendiendo en farmacias. Y por otro lado estamos hablando de que es un producto que se está legislando dentro de la normativa del tabaco. Yo mi pregunta es, ¿no podríamos sacar el cigarrillo electrónico de la farmacia y sacarlo de la directiva del tabaco y dejarlo en un punto medio y legislar sobre ello?
If there should be one.
He's proposing, if you think that that's a possible solution.
Well, it's really interesting. At the moment, in the United Kingdom, you can sell e-cigarettes everywhere. In pharmacies, at shops, the pound shop. Do you have dollar shops here, pound shop? Do you know what I mean by that? No, you don't have to. You can sell them anywhere. So in the UK, we have shops where everything costs £1. Yeah? So in those pound shops, you can buy a £1 e-cigarette. You can buy e-cigarettes online. You can buy them anywhere. No restrictions whatsoever at the moment. So, I mean, if we go down the medicinal route, all products that are licensed as medicines, technically then, depending on how it's regulated, it will have to be sold, if it's over the counter, anywhere as well, that you would buy patches or gum. But if it's regulated as a prescribed medicine, you would have to go to your doctor, you know. So again, it depends on how it is licensed, even within that. But at the moment, you can buy it anywhere. Yeah? Does that make sense?
I'd like to add something, and maybe I can speak in Spanish, maybe it's easier because you were, well, me gustaría volver un poco al punto de los. Yo no sé si se puede poner el discurso. I don't know if you can put some slides before, because
yeah,
with the discursing articles, no, in the beginning. With
beginning?
Yes. Not that one. Sorry. The next one. This.
So
this one. ¿no?
This?
This one. Well, yo quiero decir un poco y explicar un poquito por qué estoy diciendo que me parece que están bien, porque estás diciendo de alguna manera que crees que habría que estar en otro sitio. ¿Por qué entendemos que están bien donde están y que si se atribuyen capacidades medicinales deberían estar en una directiva de medicamentos? Eso suena lógico. ¿Pero por qué tienen que estar en la del tabaco? Yo entiendo que si funcionan como medicamentos, deben regularse como medicamentos. En Europa somos muy prudentes con los medicamentos, requieren una serie de trabajos científicos muy serios. Podemos tener una vacuna contra el SIDA, pero hasta que no está claramente demostrado todo lo que producen, no se pone a la venta. Si se consideran medicamentos, son medicamentos y requieren algo muy estricto, ¿vale? Si no son medicamentos, los dejamos en un punto medio. Nosotros pensamos que no. ¿Por qué? Pues un poco por esto. Los cigarrillos electrónicos pueden ser una puerta de entrada, esto dice la directiva, a la adicción, porque tienen nicotina. Estamos regulando los que tienen nicotina, ¿eh? No los que no tienen nicotina, ¿eh? Entonces, y finalmente, al consumo de tabaco. Ya hay algunos estudios que han demostrado que algunas personas han pasado del cigarrillo electrónico al... Bueno, puede ser, evidentemente, llevan nicotina, ¿no? Y algo muy importante, que explica un poco la posición, que a veces se nos puede criticar, por lo menos del comité nuestro y de muchos sanitarios, porque imitan y renormalizan la acción de fumar. O sea, en este país hemos conseguido cambiar radicalmente con las últimas leyes dos cosas que para el comité que yo presido son esenciales. Uno es la desnormalización de fumar. O sea, aquí se pensaba que lo normal era fumar. Yo tengo un hijo que fuma. En España fuma el 25% de la gente, pero el fumador percibe que todo el mundo fuma. Mi hijo me dice, papá, todos fuman. Digo, no, hijo, no. La mayoría de la gente no fuma. Pero el fumador piensa que todo el mundo fuma. Entonces, ha sido un gran paso, la ley del 2005 y la del 2010 en España, y me envuelvo un poco a donde estamos, ¿no? El excluir al tabaco de la vida normal. Si lo normal es no fumar. Entonces, esto, quieras que no, imita la conducta de fumar. Entonces, psicológicamente, nos preocupa mucho en el comité que esto se... El cigarrillo electrónico da en la línea de flotación de la renormalización y la introducción nuevamente del consumo de tabaco, de la figura de fumar. Y luego, el tema de la percepción del riesgo. O sea, nos ha costado en este país sangre, sudor y lágrimas a los sanitarios demostrar, y en todo el mundo, los riesgos del tabaco. Fíjate que hace, en los años 50 se demostró que producía cáncer de pulmón y se decía que no era verdad. Fíjate que el tabaquismo pasivo, hace nada, nos decían que era una invención de los médicos. Ya no lo discute nadie. La población, gracias a las leyes que ha habido en España, ha podido participar en debates y nos ha dado la prensa, los medios, hemos tenido la oportunidad de hablar y de transmitir mensajes de salud a la población que se nos echan por tierra cuando aparece un producto que, haciendo lo mismo que fumar, resulta que ya no es peligroso. Y luego sí que es peligroso. O sea, se intenta decir que no es peligroso. La percepción del riesgo, se quiere acabar con ella, ¿vale? Que hemos conseguido introducirla. Y luego estamos viendo que probablemente no sea tan tóxico. O sea, realmente el cigarrillo lleva monóxido de carbono, porque se quema aquí, no hay monóxido de carbono. El monóxido de carbono es responsable de muchos cánceres, ¿vale? Estos no van a producirse con el cigarrillo electrónico. Probablemente no lleva alquitrán. El alquitrán es responsable de muchos problemas. Pero sí tiene otras cosas que son tóxicas. Estamos en un nivel de excelencia en la salud en el que esto no es aceptable. O si es aceptable, el ciudadano debe conocerlo. Y entonces, a nosotros, desde el comité, a los sanitarios, a los que estamos en el control del tabaco, nos preocupa mucho el ataque en la línea de flotación a estos dos conceptos que nos ha costado mucho introducir en la sociedad española, europea y mundial. Por eso nos preocupa. No somos talibanes, que de alguna manera creo que intentamos colocar las cosas en su sitio. La directiva aporta información, garantías al ciudadano, al consumidor, oportunidad a estos productos. Si de verdad sirviesen algún día para dejar de fumar o para lo que sea, estaremos encantados de aceptarlo, pero teniendo en cuenta lo que nos pueden causar entre medio y lo que pueden acarrear de retroceso en la salud pública. Esa es la posición nuestra, que no es fundamentalista, creo que es razonada, y que, bueno, es una opinión, yo acepto todas las opiniones contrarias, pero creo que en este aspecto los sanitarios de este país lo tenemos muy claro, y lo hemos trasladado a nuestros políticos. A veces no nos han oído, a veces sí. Yo espero que se nos oiga, y que cuando se legisle en este país en el futuro, en relación con aspectos que tengan que ver con la salud, se nos tenga en cuenta los sanitarios. ¿Eh? Perdón,
yes, I agree with all of that. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, my friend.
Great.
Bueno, no sé si te contesto. Si,
Yeah. One last question, please. Two last question. Okay. Fine.
Martina, do you know anything about cessation rates in Germany? Because
Yes.
In Istanbul, we listened to Professor Robert West, and he claimed that in UK, that there were no sign of cessation rates changing. They are not going up, but they are not going faster down either. So maybe Marisa knows something about UK, but maybe you know something about Germany.
We have the data in Germany, and we have exactly the same rates like in UK, even if you have no smoking cessation program and no investment in smoking cessation. In UK, it's around 25% of the population have smokers rate. It's the same in Germany. So, I think...
Are more people trying to quit, quitting, or are less people quitting?
No, it's just the same. It's just the same.
As
there's no big difference.
As before e-cigarettes.
Before e-cigarettes, there's no... Well, it's too short. I think the time of the e-cigarettes is starting maybe 2 years ago.
I wouldn't want to comment on the, I'm not familiar with the latest figures. My understanding, listening to Robert's previous talks, and I don't know, so you'll please go and check, but I think he's recently published, and I think that more people are quitting, I think. Yeah, and my understanding is that fewer are using NRT, licensed NRT products. So we don't know what's happening there yet, and I think that was the gist of it. But I know he's recently published the latest toolkit data, so I wouldn't want to quote him on this. He can quote himself, but the data is there. You can go and have a look at that.
Elif. My final question. I'm sorry for being such a confused lady, I'm stuck with this 20 milligrams. Just imagine that I'm a tobacco industry and I've got one product which is 15 milligrams and I've got another product 30 milligrams. Will I be tobacco industry and pharmaceutical industry at the same time? The directive automatically declares this product as a medicine. I do not think that the directive or the EU has the power to declare any product as medicine. There are other routes of doing that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Francesco.
Well, and also Juan Ramon, but it has to, if one product has more than 20 milligrams, it has to be registered as medicament. After it will be accepted, that's the law, it will be accepted or not. If passes many, many controls, if demonstrates that really serves for anything, or I don't know exactly, if it has no contraindications, it has no side effects, it has no other risks, that's a very complicated process. But of course, that's the law in Europe. And that should be the law in law. But maybe Juan Ramon wanted to clarify something.
I just want to clarify that if you sell a 15 milligram product, then it's with the general product rules of law. If you have a high contents of nicotine, then you must go the same path that any pharmaceutical product does.
Yeah.
So you have to show efficacy, you'll have to show safety, you'll have to show a lot of things that none of these products can. So in practice, what the directive has done is has expelled from the market anything above 20 milligrams.
Yeah, it's true.
And
absolutely.
The point you raise about the tobacco industry becoming a pharmaceutical industry is the one
Should
that we spoke about in our paper in 2012, predicting that this might happen. And the situation that we have now is that, by definition, legally, as soon as these companies, tobacco companies, start licensing their products as medicines, how can we exclude them? You know, how can we have one rule for pharmaceutical companies, which started off, and then those that now have licensed pharmaceutical products that are owned by the tobacco industry? We couldn't possibly have two separate rules for them. And this was our greatest concern going into this debate, because that means they have the same rights to access policymakers to sure. influence policy. You know, what about Article 5.3?
Right.
You know, what happens then?
Right.
Can they be here? You know, should, and technically, if they have licensed products, they should be able to sponsor, much like the pharmaceutical companies, sponsor symposiums. You know, these are really big, big questions for tobacco control. And if it is on the market in the UK, for example, then for the NHS, are we going to start allowing that drug to be on the market and then for that money to be going back into the pockets of the industry that is causing, you know, smoking-related illnesses? You know, so these are the big questions which we put forward, and now we're in a very real situation where this might happen this year even. So that's a very important point that you raised.
Thank you very much, Marisa. Thank you very much, Francisco. It was a very interesting session. Okay, and I can pass now to Esteve. Thank you so much. Thanks.